The Senate will come to order. I ask all present to please rise and repeat the Pledge of Allegiance with me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Our invocation today will be given by Pastor Jonathan Shaw, Sr. of the Crown Ministries International of Brooklyn, New York.
Eternal Father, our Lord, we come before you this day, thanking you for the grace that you have given us to behold another day in which we have never seen before. It is now, O Lord, that we ask upon you to grant us thy favor, thy grace, thy ambition, that we may lead and that we may guide in truth and righteousness. As we follow you, we know that we shall be led properly. As you lead us, we shall be led. As you keep us, we shall be kept. We thank you for this. We thank you for your love and kindness. We thank you for your generosity. It is in your precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Reading of the journal.
In Senate Tuesday, May 31st, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Monday, May 30th, was read and approved. On motion, Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands. Approved as read. Presentations of petitions. Messages from the Assembly. Secretary will read.
On page 25, Senator Oppenheimer moves to discharge from the Committee on Agriculture Assembly Bill number 6373A and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill number 3911A, third reading calendar 349.
Substitution order.
On page 42, Senator Farley moved to discharge from the Committee on Health Assembly Bill number 3338 and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill 4566, third reading calendar 596.
Substitution ordered.
And on page 48, Senator Savino moves to discharge from the Committee on Finance Assembly Bill number 6823 and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill 4504, third reading calendar 668.
Substitution ordered.
He's got one more. Got one more, Chris? That's it.
Messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Breslin.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of Senator Perkins, I wish to call up bill print number 3252-A, recall from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 192 by Senator Perkins, Senate print 3252-A. An act to authorize certain health care professionals.
Mr. President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill was passed.
Secretary will call the roll on reconsideration.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Samson, Skelos, Zeldin, ayes 47.
Mr. President, I now offer the following amendments.
Amendments are received.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Senator Valesky.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Klein on page 23, I offer the following amendments to calendar number 312, Senate print 3992, and ask that said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
Amendments are received, and the bill will retain its place on the calendar. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, I have a number of motions that I need to do at this time on behalf of Senator McDonald. I wish to call up his bill, print number 2152, recalled from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 101 by Senator McDonald, Senate print 2152, an act to amend chapter 542 of the laws of 1997.
Mr. President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill is passed.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Samson, Skelos, Zeldin, ayes 48.
Mr. President, I offer up the following amendments.
Amendments are received.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Young, I call up her bill 3499, recalled from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 393 by Senator Young, Senate print 3499, act to amend the town law.
And I will
to the vote by which this bill is passed.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes, 48.
Mr. President, I offer up the following amendments.
Amendments are received.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Libous, I wish to call up my bill, print number 2462, recalled from the Assembly, which is now at the desk.
Call the roll on reconsideration. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 106 by Senator Libous, Senate print 2462, an act to amend the environmental conservation law.
Mr. President, I now move to reconsider the vote by which this bill is passed.
Call the roll on reconsideration.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes, 51.
Mr. President, I now offer up the following amendments.
Amendments received.
Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Galvin, I move the following bill be discharged from its respective committee and be recommitted with instruction to strike the enacting clause. That would be Senate print 3454.
So ordered.
And Mr. President, on behalf of Senator Maziarz, I would move that his bill be discharged from its respective committee and be recommitted with instructions to strike the enacting clause on Senate print 202.
So ordered.
Mr. President, I have a number of amendments that I'm going to offer up to the following third reading calendar bills, if I may. On behalf of Senator Saland, page 17, calendar 172, Senate print 1415A. Senator Seward, page 18, calendar 199, Senate print 2370. Senator Ball, page 38, calendar number 541, Senate print 4554. Senator DeFrancisco, be page 41, calendar number 581, Senate print 2857A. Senator Hannan, page 42, calendar number 598, Senate print 4991. Senator McDonald, page 42, 602 would be the calendar number, 2153 is the Senate print. Senator Johnson, page 42, calendar number 606, Senate print 4740B. Senator Ritchie, page 43, calendar number 620, Senate print 5168. Senator Maziarz, page 48, calendar number 672, Senate print 4253. Senator Saland would be page 53, calendar number 731. Senate print 4873. Senator Young, it would be on page 55, calendar number 751, Senate print number 4621. Mr. President, I now move that these bills retain their place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received and adopted, and the bills will retain their place on the calendar.
And Mr. President, I apologize, but I've been handed some more amendments. If I may, these amendments would be offered on the following third reading calendar bills. Senator Young, page 56, calendar number 764, Senate print 4758. Senator Lavelle, page 57, calendar number 777, Senate print 4546. Senator Martins, page 57, calendar number 780, Senate print 5055. And Senator Hannan, page 58, calendar number 794, Senate print 4894. I move that these bills retain their place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received and adopted. The bills will retain their place on the calendar.
Mr. President, at this time, I believe there are three privilege resolutions at the desk by Senator Skelos. May we have the titles read and move for their immediate adoption.
Secretary will read.
Legislative resolution by Senator Skelos commending Ann and Elliot Taub upon the occasion of their designation for special recognition by Temple Avoda of Oceanside as honorees of his Twilight Journal dinner dance on June 5th, 2011. Legislative resolution by Senator Skelos commending Anita and Lewis Hoyne upon their occasion of designation for special recognition by Temple Avoda of Oceanside as honorees of his Twilight Journal dinner dance on June 5th, 2011. And legislative resolution by Senator Skelos commending Morris Lipton upon his occasion of his designation for special recognition by Temple Avoda of Oceanside as honoree of his Twilight Journal dinner dance on June 5th, 2011.
The question is on the resolutions. All in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The resolution is adopted. Senator Libous.
Oh, you're next. Mr. President, I believe Senator Breslin has a privilege resolution at the desk. Could we have the title read and move for its adoption?
Secretary will read.
Legislative Resolution Number 2164 by Senator Breslin, commending Albany County Executive Michael G. Breslin upon the occasion of his designation for special recognition for his dedication to the County of Albany, New York.
The question is on the resolution. All in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The resolution is adopted. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, there's another privilege resolution by Senator Skelos, 2121. Could we have the title read and move for its immediate adoption?
Secretary will read.
Legislative Resolution Number 2121 by Senator Skelos, commemorating the 75th anniversary of the National Council of Jewish Women, Peninsula Section, and honoring Joan Regal, recipient of its prestigious Hannah G. Salomon Award.
The question is on the resolution. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The resolution is adopted. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, at this time, could we take up the reading of the non-controversial calendar?
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 25 by Senator Marcelino, Senate Print 947, Act to Amend the Criminal Procedure Law.
Bills laid aside.
Calendar number 46 by Senator Mazier, Senate Print 234, an act to amend the Arts and Cultural Affairs Law.
Home rule messages at the desk. Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 138 by Senator Fuchillo, Senate Print 3451A, an act to amend the penal law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 243 by Senator Grisanti, Senate Print 3791. An act to amend the Environmental Conservation Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 255 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 3641A, an act to amend the Highway Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 309 by Senator Grisanti, Senate Print 2877A, an act to amend the Environmental Conservation Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 320 by Senator Fuchillo, Senate Print 4070, an act to amend the Vehicle and Traffic Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 347 by Senator Lavalle, Senate Print 3237, an act to amend the Agricultural Markets Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 348 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate Print 3317, an act to amend the Agricultural Markets Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 349, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly, Cahill, Senate Print 6373A, an act to amend the Agricultural Markets Law.
Lay it aside. I'll do it for you.
No, I don't think you want it.
No, I do.
Calendar number 383 by Senator Bonasek, Senate Print 3579, an act to amend the rural Calendar number 415 by Senator Klein, Senate Print 1677, Act to Amend the Executive Law. Calendar number 427 by Senator Young, Senate Print 2835, and Act to Amend the Criminal Procedure Law.
Bills laid aside.
Calendar number 438 by Senator Savino, Senate Print 2138, an act to amend the Workers' Compensation Law.
Lay it aside.
Calendar number 523 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 4803, an act to amend the Public Health Law.
Bills laid aside.
Calendar number 547 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 4521, an act to amend the Public Authorities Law.
Bills laid aside.
Calendar number 556 by Senator Nozzolio, Senate Print 464, an act to amend the penal law.
Bill's laid aside.
Calendar number 557 by Senator Marcelino, Senate Print 946, an act to amend the penal law.
Bill's laid aside.
Calendar number 558 by Senator Golden, Senate Print 1991, an act to amend the penal law.
Bill's laid aside.
Calendar number 561 by Senator Salan, Senate Print 4092, an act to amend the criminal procedure law.
Read the last section.
Section 3 of this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 59.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 568 by Senator Farley, Senate Print 4564, an act to legalize, validate, and ratify.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 596, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly, Godfrey, Assembly Print 3338, an act to amend the public health law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 616 by Senator Balls, Senate Print 5270, an act to amend the penal law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 630 by Senator Maziar, Senate Print 3793, an act authorizing town of Carlton.
There's a Senator Maziar, there's a home rule message at the desk. Did you lay the bill aside?
Yes.
Lay the bill aside.
Calendar number 636 by Senator Marcelino, Senate Print 4229.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 668, substituted earlier today by member of the Assembly, Paulin. Assembly Print 6823.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 684 by Senator Grisanti, Senate Print 2650, an act to amend the Environmental Conservation Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 732 by Senator Salan, Senate Print 4921, an act to amend the Education Law.
Bill is laid aside.
Calendar number 753 by Senator Young, Senate Print 5210, an act to amend the Public Health Law.
Read the last section.
Section.
Last bill on the calendar.
Section 4 of this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 60.
The bill is passed. Senator Libous, that concludes the non-controversial reading of the calendar.
Thank you, Mr. President. It appears to have something in the drinking water here in Albany, or maybe the fact that the sunshine has come out today. For whatever reason, we will now approach the controversial calendar, which we have many bills on. So we will start with the beginning of the controversial calendar, and I would ask that maybe you ring the bell because all members should come to the chamber. I will make a note that if members are not in the chamber, we will wait a reasonable amount of time for roll call. Otherwise, I am moving forward.
Yes. I urge members to please come into the chamber. We're on the controversial reading of the calendar, and we will begin immediately. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 25 by Senator Marcelino, Senate Print 947, an act to amend the criminal procedure law.
Senator Marcelino, explanation has been requested.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill would permit the court to issue an order precluding disclosure of jurors' names and addresses upon a showing by the people that such an order is necessary to prevent bribery, jury tampering, or physical injury to or harassment of jurors.
Thank you, Senator Marcelino. Is there any senator wishing to be heard? Senator Breslin.
Yes, will the sponsor yield to a few questions?
Senator Marcelino, will you yield for a question?
Yes.
Senator Breslin.
Thank you, Mr. President. Through you, Mr. President, was there any particular reason to include a business address as well as a home address in this legislation?
Excuse me for one second. We have some conversations. Let's take them out. We're on debate here, and the members want to hear each other and as well as everyone else. Continue, please.
Yes, Mr. President, through you, the reason is very simple. The idea is to hide the identity of the juror, and since revealing where you work obviously reveals who you are, we decide that that's a good idea.
Dear Mr. President, the sponsor continue to yield.
Senator Marcellino, will you continue to yield?
Absolutely.
The legislation has a three-day notice before which a prosecutor can move to block the names. Does this three-day notice present the possibility of interfering in any way with a speedy trial?
No, Senator.
Can you tell us why not?
Because we think 72 hours is not going to delay anybody's speedy trial in any way, shape, or form.
But wouldn't it be true that after
Is the
that
Senator asking me to yield, Mr. President?
I asked for several questions.
Yes, will you continue to yield, Senator Marcellino?
Yes, I would continue to yield.
Okay.
Through you, Mr. President, with the fact that there's the possibility of a motion after that by the defense and significant possibilities of delays, would that in any way interfere with a speedy trial?
We don't believe so.
Can you, through you, Mr. President, can you tell us why that wouldn't be a factor?
Because if these are motions relative to the defendant's concerns or the victim's concerns, whatever the legitimate court process is, we don't consider those delays in the system. That's just the normal court process in a normal doing business, order of doing business.
And again, through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will you continue to yield, Senator Marcellino?
Yes, I do.
Could you tell us what the defendant would need to argue to overcome the prosecutor's demand to have these names excluded?
Frankly, no.
Through you again, Mr. President, would the imposition, imposition of this rule, would it interfere constitutionally or statutorily within the voir dire process for the lawyers, the defense lawyers' inability to obtain enough information to determine whether you should keep that juror on the jury or not?
We don't believe so, Senator. We believe that it is more important to keep the safety of the jurors and the sanctity of the impaneling process so that no one can tamper or harass a juror or, in fact, in some cases, threaten the jurors for participating in a particular kind of trial.
And again, through you, Mr. President, would the sponsor continue to yield?
I continue to yield.
When the prosecutor exercises his three-day notice, could you list for us the factors that the judge should consider before making a decision?
That would relate to the specific judge, and I would think that the judge would make that determination upon each individual judge would determine that as they require. Different judges might require different levels of proof or different levels of substantiation, and I think that would leave that up to the judge.
Again, through you, Mr. President, but the sponsor continue to yield.
Senator Marcellino, do you continue to yield?
Yes, I continue to yield.
Are you suggesting then that the criteria to be used by a particular judge can change from one judge to another, and whatever a particular judge thinks is important, he has the right to use that information to preclude the address of a particular defendant or witness?
While the law in most cases has the same language, everyone would understand that that becomes open to somewhat interpretation by different judges, hence you get different decisions. One would think that each judge would make a determination based on the same facts. You might get different determinations from different judges based on the same set of facts. So, that's just human nature. We think it could happen.
But again, through you, Mr. President, sponsor, continue to yield.
Senator Marcellino, do you continue to yield?
Yes, I do.
Should there not be standards to be followed by a particular judge in making that determination?
You can supply all the standards in the world you want. Still, human nature is human nature.
Then if there was an appeal taken, should the argument be that it was against human nature? Or should there be more definitive reasons to ascertain that decision?
Mr. President, I'm not going to engage in what I would consider silly questions. You want to ask me a question I'll be happy to answer it.
Marcelino, do you want to...
Let me just answer the question. The senator is well aware that I am not an attorney and I'm not attempting to argue as an attorney, but I will suspect that the judges will take this in all seriousness and would not make frivolous decisions in any case.
I am not being at all, through you, Mr. President, I'm not at all being disrespectful for the fact that you're not an attorney. I'm only trying to ascertain the particular protections that we would have to make sure there's some degree of objectivity. Again, through you, Mr. President, the sponsor continue to yield.
Senator Marcelino, do you continue to yield?
Yes.
Given the fact that you said you're not an attorney, did you seek out the Office of Court Administration? And if so, what did they provide you in determining this legislation?
I do yield, and as the senator is well aware, this bill has been brought up on several different occasions. The judge would have to take into consideration the following situations: whether or not the defendant or the person acting on the defendant's behalf have bribed, tampered with, or caused or attempted to cause physical injury to or harassment of a juror, prospective juror, or a witness or prospective witnesses in another criminal action or proceeding, or in the instant proceeding, whether the defendant is a member of a group that has manifested an intention to harm or intimidate witnesses or jurors; three, the seriousness of the charges against the defendant; and four, the extent of pretrial publicity about the criminal action or proceeding.
Again, with the sponsor continuing to yield, I think the answer to a prior question. As it says, the advice of the Office of Court Administration then solicited and received.
At the beginning of this process, and they came up with some of our guidelines as to what we are dealing with today.
Again, through you, Mr. President.
By the way, this bill is support. This was a program bill that came out. I'm clearing my head a little bit because it goes back some time. This was a program bill that was put out some time ago, and this bill is supported by the state of New York Unified Court System.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor continue to yield.
Yes, I continue to yield.
Given the 10% cut in the Office of Court Administration's budget this year, was advice sought this year on this particular bill?
No.
And again, through you, Mr. President.
Do you continue to yield, Senator Marcelino?
Yes, I do.
Given the timing involved in this bill and the potential for long delays, has there been any sort of cost assessment placed on this legislation?
No, there is not, or has not been to my knowledge.
And just through you, Mr. President, one or two more questions. There is an area of concern that a defense lawyer tries to know as much as he can about a prospective juror, and it's critically important to ascertain backgrounds, whether they've been involved in this type of situations before, and a lot of information, their occupations, which might lend itself towards the disclosure of the name. Does the sponsor believe that this restriction will have any kind of negative influence in the ultimate disposition of the defendant?
Mr. President, this bill does not preclude the defense's attorney from getting this information. It precludes the defendant from getting the information. The attorney would be permitted to get the information that they need to do the proper interrogation, the proper questioning of the potential jurors, but would be under restriction from revealing that same information to the defendant. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you to the sponsor.
If there is no other senator, is there any other senator wishing to be heard? Read the last section. Debate is closed. I'm sorry. Ring the bell. Please come to the chamber for the vote. Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect on the 30th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, E. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
No negatives, but absentees.
Senator Breslin to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I first of all, would thank the sponsor for being so indulgent of me on various questions, which I think are important to the judicial process. I have voted for this bill before. The answers that were given will make me continue to vote for this bill. I'd prefer voting for an ethics bill or a rent control bill, but I vote aye on this particular bill. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Breslin. You'll be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Krueger.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I also wish that we were dealing with bigger picture bills for the state of New York. I, too, am particularly concerned about our failure to address rent regulation, strengthening now on June 1st with the bill coming up for sunset on June 15th. I don't know that I was completely satisfied with the answers of the sponsor, but I will be voting yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Krueger. You recorded in the affirmative. Announce the result.
In relation to calendar number 25, ayes 58, nay 0. Absent from voting are Senators Huntley, C. Krueger, and Smith.
The bill is passed, and I would encourage members to stay in the chamber or close by as we continue on the controversial calendar. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 46 by Senator Maziar, Senate Print 234, an act to amend the Arts and Cultural Affairs Law.
Senator Maziar's explanation has been asked for.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. This legislation, which was a home rule message, was at the request of the Niagara County Legislature and the various local governments in Niagara County, would allow for the chief executive officer of each municipality to appoint the local historian.
Senator Serrano.
Mr. President, will the sponsor please yield?
Senator Maziarz, will you yield?
Absolutely, Mr. President. Senator.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. President. I have a question regarding this bill.
Yes.
I do think it's important that counties, for tourism purposes, have a very robust county historian, someone who can serve as a person to help give a good historical perspective, educational perspective for the counties. My question is, what is the process involved with selecting this historian? I know in the bill it calls upon the CEO to make the selection, but what sort of process would be in place?
Thank you, Senator, for that question. First, let me say that in Niagara County, and this bill specifically is for Niagara County only, I think other than the county historian, the historian's positions are all on a voluntary basis, or they get paid a very nominal fee. There are no like full-time historians involved here. And of the 12 towns, Senator, many of them are very small rural town community. Right now, and that's the problem, I think that's why the county and the local municipalities asked for this bill, is because in some towns there really are no rules set forth. The historians maybe tend to be the historian for as long as they want to be the historian. This would actually establish a criteria that the chief executive officer, be it in the cities, the mayor, the town supervisor, would appoint the historian for a term coterminous with their own term, so that the new supervisor, new mayor could make that appointment.
Now, what about, I'm sorry, through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor yield?
Certainly,
continue.
Mr. President.
Thank you. Through you, will the process include a public process, meaning there are many folks in the community, I know in my community, for example, would be very interested in knowing who the candidate would be for such a position, a prestigious position. Is there a public process beyond the executives that you mentioned?
Anything. When the chief executive officer gets elected, I mean, they have varying process of how they select their team. I would presume that this would follow right along with that. Of course, Senator, I know you, being the chair or ranking member of the Tourism Committee, know that the richest history in the entire state of New York is in Niagara County, with Niagara Falls, Old Fort Niagara. I know, Mr. President, that you are well aware that the Allen Herschel Company manufactured just about every carousel in the world on the corner of Thompson and Vandenberg Streets in the city of North Tonawanda. One block from my home.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Absolutely. And I am full of historical facts about Niagara County. I will yield all day.
He will yield all day, Senator Serrano.
Thank you, Senator. And I appreciate your comments about the carousels. And I think that those are all very important issues, not just in Niagara, but throughout the entire state, for ways that we could increase tourism. So I do think that this is a good effort and a very important effort. An additional question I have is, I believe that we've taken this bill up before. Am I correct?
I believe it has passed the Senate before, yes.
Now, is there any, through you, Mr. President, is there a reason why it didn't go all the way?
I think, Mr. President, in the past, the bill was statewide, and that created some problems in other counties, because apparently there are some counties that have a civil service position and some municipalities that have a civil service position as a paid historian. So we went back to the people in Niagara County, the governmental leaders in Niagara County, and said that if we could do this for just Niagara County the way that they wanted it done, it would gain wider acceptance in the assembly.
And through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor yield?
You continue to yield,
yes.
Senator Maziarz?
I have one final question, Senator Maziarz. You mentioned that this legislation is specific to Niagara County.
Yes.
Do you know of any major differences between the process that would be theoretically set up here and processes that we would have, other than the fact that they would be on a volunteer basis? Besides that, are there any other major differences?
I'm sorry, I don't quite understand the question. Are there any differences between what Niagara
between
County does
and what other counties would do? Correct.
Senator Serrano, I can assure you that the way Niagara County does it is better than any other county in the state of New York.
Senator Serrano, for one moment, if you could just get a little bit of order in the chamber. If you have an important conversation, please just take it outside, and then we just need you guys to go one at a time for the stenographer.
Oh.
I was... Thank you, Mr. President. I haven't finished my answer yet, Mr. Senator. The way Niagara County does it is much better than the way they do it in Brooklyn or Staten Island or some of those other places. Not the Bronx, though. Not the Bronx.
Through you, Mr. President, just to expand a little bit on that, Senator Mazur, are there some specific differences? I know that you say it's better, and I won't argue with you on that, but is there any specific differences?
Yes. Well, I think I pointed out before about the carousels, you know, the fact that we have Niagara Falls. We just have more historical sites, and I think that our people have more of an appreciation for history maybe than some other areas of the state. I don't want to disparage any other areas, Senator, but I just think that we do better. With almost all volunteers, I think other than the county historian, the only other one that may get paid, I'm sorry, the only one that may get a salary, actually, is the county historian. The others are almost all volunteers or get a very nominal fee to cover their expenses.
Got it. No further questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator. Thank you, Mr. President.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Senator Diaz.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen, there are over 25 pieces of legislation that have been put on hold today. The way things appear, it looks like we're going to be here today till about 1 o'clock in the morning or more. So this is a good opportunity for people from the city of New York, taxi drivers up there, because I love taxi drivers, I love senior citizens, and I love...
Senator Diaz, are you on the bill?
I'm on the bill.
Okay, let's make your comments, Jermaine.
So I love taxi drivers, I love senior citizens, and I love bodegueros. And those people that are there from the city of New York, taxi drivers, under the leadership of Cedar Angeles and
Senator Diaz, I'm trying to be very cordial.
I am on the bill. We're going to be here. Mr. President.
Senator Libous.
Mr. President, I'm on the bill. We're going to be here all day today.
Senator Diaz, one moment, please. Senator Libous.
Point of order, Mr. President. I believe we're on the bill. I know Senator Diaz would like to, at some point, probably ask for unanimous consent so he could get up and address some of his constituents that are here. But I think if we could do the vote on the bill,
yes.
I would then ask Senator Diaz for you to have...
Senator Diaz, if we could finish the bill, and if you would like to then address the other topic...
Finish.
Okay. Well, finish on the bill.
Almost finished on the bill.
Okay.
That bill gives the opportunity to people to see how is it that we're dealing here. This bill shows how the people from Niagara Falls, how the deals, and this bill shows how we debate here. Sometimes useless, sometimes nonsense, sometimes we call bills on hold for nothing, just to waste time. And this is a good opportunity for the people of the city of New York, taxi driver, to see how business are done. And sooner or later, Mr. President, as we do with this bill, from Ontario, Canada, from Niagara Falls, as we do with this bill, sooner or later, Mr. President, we're gonna be dealing with a bill that affects the life of more than 30,000 city drivers. And they're going to come here, and we're going to debate it as we are debating.
Thank you, Senator Diaz.
I am on the bill.
You're really not.
Yes, I am, sir. I am on the bill. I'm talking about the bill from Niagara Falls, and this bill from.
Senator Diaz, your comments are not germane. You're out of order. I'm trying to be very accommodating here.
And I'm trying to be.
Senator Liz Krueger on the bill.
No, that is not the right thing to do.
Well, are you going to speak on the bill or not, Senator Diaz?
I'm talking on the bill. I'm going to talk on the bill.
Senator Diaz.
I have the floor. And you want to be, are you going to play that game? I could play that game too.
Roll call, Senator Diaz. It's not a game.
Mr. President.
Do you have some comments on the bill?
Yes, and the bill reads that we have the bill. Yeah, the bill says that Niagara is the only county that has a CEO. The other county has local historians. The law currently says that the county can have local historians. Does it specify how county? What I'm trying to tell you, Mr. President, is that we have 25 bills today that Mike Kelly has put on hold. We are going to go through this thing all day long. There are people that come from the city of New York that could look at this thing better and see things better. And what we're doing is wasting time. I am supporting the bill, and I'm voting for this bill. But please, let's stop this game. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to defer my time to Senator Diaz if he still has more things he wanted to say. Senator Diaz, did you have anything else you wanted to say? I was going to defer to you if you had more things you wanted to say.
Senator Diaz has yielded the floor. Did you want to speak on the bill or ask a question?
Yes, I wanted to ask the sponsor a question, Mr. President.
Certainly, Mr. President.
Senator Maziarz will yield.
Certainly.
Thank you. In your description and answers to my colleague Senator Serrano's questions, you referenced the carousel maker in your district.
Alan Herschel.
So I have two carousels in my district, in Central Park and in Bryant Park. Do you know if either
they
of those?
They are both Alan Herschel carousels,
They're
Senator.
They're both Alan. Yes. Thank you very much.
It's just another thing. It's one more thing, Senator, that upstate New York gave to the city of New York.
We love the carousels, Mr. President. Thank you.
Senator Rivera. Thank you, Mr. President. I wonder if the sponsor would yield for a few questions.
Senator Maziarz, will you yield?
Certainly, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Maziarz. Thank you, Mr. President. We're certainly not going to debate, at least you accepted, Niagara versus Bronx. So I'm not going to debate you on that one because you already yielded.
Well, actually, I said positive things about the Bronx. It was Brooklyn and Staten Island that I...
We could definitely have some conversation about Brooklyn and Staten Island. But on the bill, I actually wanted to ask you a few questions about the historian. First of all, what are the qualifications for the historian? Are there any qualifications for that person?
There are, Senator Rivera. Each municipality actually sets its own, and generally they defer to the chief executive officer. Again, usually when a town supervisor is elected, and I can tell you that most of the town supervisors in this county serve for a long time. When a new one comes in, they generally select the people that they want. Again, these are volunteer positions. They have many committees and organizations.
Okay. Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to yield?
Certainly, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Now, but so there's no qualifications like a master's or a PhD in history or anything of that nature?
I believe for the county historian that there are, I don't believe. I know that for the county historian, which I think may be a part-time position. I may be wrong on that particular fact, but the county historian, the only one that is paid a salary, there are qualifications for that. And the county legislature does make that particular appointment.
We don't have
a county executive. We have a county legislature, so they make that particular appointment.
Okay. Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Will you continue to yield,
yes,
Senator Maziarz?
Mr. President.
Thank
continue.
You.
So the county of Niagara is different than Niagara County?
The county historian is appointed by the county legislature. This
Which
bill
is the one that
encompasses
we're speaking
not
about.
Just the county, but the 12 towns and 3 cities located within the county.
Gotcha. Through you, Mr. President, if the council, the sponsor would continue to yield.
You continue to yield,
yes,
Senator Maziarz?
Yes.
Continue, Senator Rivera.
Thank you. How long would the... So there's no real requirement as far as books written, area of specialization for the historian as far as the requirements?
No.
All right. Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to you.
Senator. But just to get back to your other question, this is almost always a retired individual who wants to volunteer to do this.
Now, how long would the historian actually serve for, through you, Mr. President? How long would the historian serve for?
If they're appointed by the chief executive officer, I would assume that they would serve at their pleasure.
Okay. And through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to you.
Yes, I do.
Thank you. Do they have? Is there? And I hope that the answer is yes. Do they have a residency requirement?
Oh yes. Oh, absolutely.
There is a residency requirement.
Yes, they do have a residency requirement. And in fact, to continue that answer, I can tell you that in early November of last year, our colleague Senator Gennaris visited Niagara County, visited the county courthouse, and I introduced him, he probably doesn't remember, to the county historian at that time. Now, most of our tourists don't come around the first week of November. They tend to come after Memorial Day and between Labor Day, but Senator Gennaris was the exception. He wanted to be there right after the first Tuesday, after the first Monday in November.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. President. On the bill.
On the bill, Senator Rivera.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Senator Maziarz. I will be supporting this legislation as I am in the district that I represent in the Bronx. The Bronx Historical Society actually resides in my district. Among many other historical landmarks in my district, I actually have the Poe House. Edgar Allan Poe lived in the Bronx. His wife actually died in the Bronx. And the house that his wife actually died in is physically in the district, in my district. Edgar Allan Poe.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Edgar Allan Poe. So that is only one of the many historical historical landmarks that are in the Bronx and certainly in my district. So I will be supportive of this bill. I would only suggest that not only does a person reside in Niagara, but Senator Maziarz, I would think that person, if that person is either a PhD, has a master's, maybe they've written some books in Niagara, probably that would be the best person to be able to fulfill that role. That's the only thing that I would suggest. But besides that, good luck to whomever that person is. Maybe we can get you to do it, Senator. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rivera, for supporting landmark legislation. Senator Gennaris.
Thank you, Mr. President. On the bill.
On the bill.
I appreciated Senator Maziarz's comments. In fact, I do rise in support of this bill, but I couldn't let his comments go without stating how much I actually enjoyed my trip to Western New York, as I do frequently. I like to go at all times of the year. And November was a pleasure, and it was a pleasure to see him and to meet the historian at that time. I've since been back several times, and I expect I'll be back next year again, and hopefully it will be an even more enjoyable experience than it was last year. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Is there any other senator wishing to be heard? The debate is closed. Ring the bell. Can the members please come to the chamber for the vote?
Section.
Home rule messages at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 2 of this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco Libous, Samson Skelos Zeldin.
Announce it, Chris.
Ayes 58, nays 3. Absent from voting are Senators C. Krueger, Oppenheimer, and Smith.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 138 by Senator Fuchsillo, Senate Print 3451A, an act to amend the penal law.
Explanation has been requested.
Senate Squadron, this bill amends the penal law in relation to criminal trespassing on railroad property. The bill is supported by the railroads of New York State. According to them, in their memo of support, trespassing is the most significant cause of death attributed to railroad operations in New York State. More than 500 deaths nationwide are preventable each year. New York State laws are antiquated. This bill passed unanimously in the Senate last year.
Sponsor. Senator Squadron.
Thank you, Mr. President. The sponsor yield.
Yes, I'd be happy to.
Thank you very much. I noticed that the new definition of the penal law references railroad property. What types of railroads would that include?
What type of railroads? The ones with trains on them.
Through you, Mr. President, would the sponsor continue?
Yield, Senator Fuchsillo.
I'd be happy to.
Go ahead, Senator Squadron.
So would that include, for example, New York City Transit subway tracks and subway property?
Yes. They have trains, yes. Yes, Senator.
And would the sponsor continue to yield?
Continue to yield, Senator Fuchsillo?
Yes, Mr. President.
So presumably that would also include the PATH train operated by the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, though it's a bi-state agency.
Mr. President, through you, Senator Squadron, the answer is yes.
The PATH train does, in fact, the PATH railroad does, in fact, have trains as well. So I expected that answer. Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor.
Senator, just to add, this bill did pass unanimously last year in the Senate by my good friend, Senator DeLon, who was the chair of transportation, now the ranking member.
Through you, Mr. President, and I am interested, let me ask, but the sponsor will continue to yield if this is identical to the bill that passed last year.
I'd be happy to yield, yes, Mr. President. This year we're working with Joe Lento, who's chairman of codes in the Assembly. We referenced the railroad law provisions now in the penal law to give it an additional strength, but in a hope, Senator, that it passes in the Assembly this year.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to yield.
Senator Fuchsillo?
I'd be happy to yield, Mr. President.
Last year, in addition to Roney, the Senator DeLon's bill, which did pass unanimously, had the support of Amtrak. Does this version?
Yes.
And if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Senator Fuchsillo?
Mr. President, I'd be happy to yield for Senator Squadron.
And it also had the support of the State Trial Lawyers Association, as I understand it. Does this version have the support of that organization as well?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Could you repeat the question, Senator Squadron?
Could we have some water in the chamber? Yes. Here.
Thank you, Senator Duane. Once again, if we could have some order in here. If you need to discuss, please just step outside so the members and everyone else can hear the debate. Thank you. Senator Squadron, could you repeat the question?
In the interest of efficiency, are there any other support, any other organizations or support memos for the current draft of the bill?
Mr. President, through you, Senator, the only memo of support we have is from the Railroad Association. It's called RONI, the Railroads of New York State.
And thank you. If the sponsor will continue to yield.
Senator Fuchsillo, do you continue to yield?
I do.
The sponsor made a brief reference to how this bill differs from the bill that garnered bipartisan support last year. Would the sponsor mind going into a little more detail about how this bill differs from
I think the only changes that were added were snowmobiles as well. But let me get into a little bit more detail for you, Senator. I believe since the mid-19th century, the laws have only been changed maybe once or twice. And since the height of advent of 9/11, the federal government has been working, the Federal Railroad Administration has been working with states throughout the entire United States, and have found that railroad trespassing laws are inadequate and outdated. one of the reasons I'm confident that Senator DeLon had introduced the bill last year and had it passed in the Senate. We've taken it a step further by looking at other laws throughout New York State and adding snowmobiles and other minor provisions with a hope that our laws, again, which have only been updated maybe twice, as they state, since the mid-19th century, are brought up to speed right now. So in the heightened awareness of homeland security issues, New York State is in the forefront in the nation in dealing with trespassing.
Thank you very much for that explanation. I just wonder, since I think a great deal of the mileage of rail that this affects would be in New York City and the New York City Transit System, has New York City Transit or the Metropolitan Transportation Authority weighed in on this bill, if the sponsor would continue to yield it? Forgive me, Mr. President.
I'm sorry. Are you on the bill?
I asked the sponsor to yield. Forgive me.
Senator Fischel, do you continue to yield?
Was that a question or just ask?
I'm not sure.
I'm sorry, Senator. I didn't hear you. The answer is
forgive me.
The answer is yes to yield. I didn't hear you, but okay.
Forgive me. I went out of order there. A great deal of the mileage that would be affected by this bill of track is in New York City, managed by New York City Transit and Metropolitan Transportation Authority, Long Island Railroad, Metro North, the other affiliates. Have any of the affiliates or the MTA weighed in on this bill?
No, we have not, but I've been talking to the Long Island Railroad, MTA, Port Authority. They share the same concerns with security issues. They don't want people trespassing on their rails. They don't want people defacing or damaging their property as well. And it is a major concern, especially in the city of New York, where you represent, in light of the tragic events that happened there in 9/11. And as I stated to you, the Federal Railroad Administration works very closely with the MTA, Port Authority, Metro North, and other railroads around New York State out of their great concern that New York State laws are severely inadequate dealing with trespassing issues. So there's a hope this year, Senator Squadron, since Chairman Lentil carries the bill in the Assembly, that it does become law and strengthens the law and prevents these acts of criminal activity.
Through you, Mr. President, just to ask, I know that Western New York, the NFTA, runs a railroad as well that goes right down the heart of the city of Buffalo. If the sponsor would continue to yield, just a brief question on that. Thank you. I assume they haven't been spoken to. Has there been consideration given to road surface tracks and rails and how this bill would affect those?
Believe it would have any negative effect. What it really does is give law enforcement, prosecutors, the necessary tools to go after those who trespass on railroad property.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And the sponsor has just the final couple of questions here. If the sponsor would continue to yield,
happy to.
Sponsor has talked somewhat. In fact, gone down to the back to the 19th century and sort of the history of legislation to protect the rails from vandalism, from acts of terrorism, other dangerous acts. He's talked about the fact that New York needs updating. Are there other states that this legislation is modeled on? Are there other states that do this, today do this better than New York does?
The answer is we have not. We've looked at what other states do. We've mostly looked at what my esteemed colleague, Senator DeLon, had done last year. We trust his judgment. We think last year's bill was a great bill. We want to make sure it gets passed in the Assembly. We do have sponsors on both sides of the aisle. But let me read to you the language from the memo of support from the railroads of New York State that lists member railroads on two pages, and I'll be happy to provide this with you, of railroads throughout New York State. Trespassing is the most significant cause of death attributed to railroad operations in New York State. Nationally, more than 500 such deaths, which are preventable, occur each year. In addition, since September 11, 2001, the extreme threat to our national transportation infrastructure has added a whole new dimension to railroad safety. In light of these additional threats, railroads have teamed up with the federal and state homeland security agencies to take a 21st century approach to trespassing and security breaches. But when it comes to enforcement of trespassing offenses in New York, the railroads are forced to do so with laws that have only seen few changes enacted since the mid-19th century. And I'm confident that my colleague, Senator DeLon, last year felt the same way that I do. Let's get out of the 19th century, and I'm sure you, feel the same way, Senator Squadron. Let's get into the 21st century. Let's give law enforcement the authority to properly charge and prosecute those that are trespassing in light of the heightened homeland security issues. And this organization represents almost two pages of railroads throughout New York State that all feel the same way, that it's about time New York State comes up to speed, and let's stop living in the past and come into the future, come into the present.
Thank you very much. Sponsor would yield for a final question.
Senator, Mr. President, yes.
Thank you. I actually don't have the list of the membership. Have the railroad entities, the public authorities that I've mentioned, are they listed as member organizations of RONI?
You have the Buffalo and Pittsburgh. You want me to read all of them for you?
No, just the ones that I brought up previously, the MTA and its affiliate railroads, the NFTA, any other commuter rail lines in the state.
They're not listed here. The MTA is not listed here, but everybody else seems to be listed here. And I'll be happy to go through all of them if you want me to.
No, it's okay. I think that might not be a good use of our time.
But I think, what's important, Senator, that this organization deals with all these private and public railroad transportation providers throughout the state and communicate with all of them. If there was opposition to this as the chairman of transportation, I would have heard it already. I haven't heard it. This has always been a priority of the railroads throughout New York State, and I hope we can count on your support today.
Thank you very much for the sponsor. On the bill, Mr. President.
On the bill, Senator Squadron.
I thank Senator Fraschillo for a really very patient recitation of the reasons for this bill and references to other states back to the 19th century. And I think that the point that the sponsor makes is critical and undeniable. We just recently, with all the trove of information that was gathered, where Osama bin Laden was brought to justice, saw that in fact there were specific plans related to coming after the rail system in New York City. As the sponsor talks about, New York City has been and continues to be one of the prime targets in the world. We've seen around the world, whether in Madrid, in London, that terrorists target rail systems. In New York City, we move more commuters by rail every single day than the rest of the country combined. As I referenced, the MTA has three affiliate railroads, the New York City Transit Authority, Metro North, Long Island Railroad. In addition, the Port Authority runs the PATH train just in New York City. We have the AirTrain as well. Up in Buffalo, all the way from Senator Maziar's district down to Senator Kennedy's, the NFTA runs a rail system. And so to make sure that New York is no longer in the 19th century is critically important. And I share the sponsor's interest in that. I also commend the sponsor for working in a bipartisan fashion with Senator DeLon, who I know carried this bill in the past, continues to co-sponsor it, passed it last year. We're not getting into that game of just passing a one house. We are working closely with the Assembly to try to make this bill into law, which is so significant. I want to commend the sponsor for all of that. I think it's significant. I do think that it's important to have explicit conversations with Metro North and with the MTA and its affiliated railroads. As I said, they move more human beings than every other railroad in this nation every single day. I am certain, as Senator Fraschillo referenced, that they are comfortable with this. I'm also certain that them weighing in directly, being involved, is an important piece of this. Rail freight is a big thing in New York State. It is very important. We have a number of rail freight corridors. We'd like to have more. But moving humans around, moving people around every single day is a big part of the terrorism risk, and it's critical. Mr. President, I will be supporting this bill. I think, as I said, Senator Fraschillo, clearly I've learned a lot asking him some questions here. I think he clearly has a real understanding and sense in a global way of why this is so critically important. I would urge discussion with the commuter rails before this becomes chaptered. If we need a chapter amendment or slight modification in this House, I'm sure we would be able to do that as well. If not, then I would just again commend the sponsor for working in a serious way on a significant piece of legislation I thank him again for the commentary, and I will be supporting this bill. Thank you, Mr. President.
Is there any other senator wishing to be heard? The debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell. Ask members to please come to the chamber for the vote. Okay. Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect on the 180th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Senator Krueger to explain her vote, and I ask members, due to the lengthy calendar, to stick to the two-minute explanation, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll happily stay within 2 minutes. I thought this was a fascinating debate. Discussion. Obviously, rail infrastructure is critical for our state, and as Senator Squadron pointed out, for my city, the city of New York, we couldn't possibly move 8 million people around if we didn't have a safe and diverse rail system. And of course, if we can't continue to assure that we have an affordable housing stock for the 8 million people in our city, we will have bigger problems than just moving people around on rail. We will need to move them out farther and farther from the city in order for them to live. So I hope that now that we're moving into infrastructure issues and concerns such as the future of modern and safe rail and protecting people who travel the rails, that we will also be taking up another critical issue for so many of our communities, the preservation and standards of quality for our affordable housing stock. Thank you, Mr. President. I vote yes.
Thank you, Senator Krueger. You'll be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the result.
In relation to calendar 138, absent from voting are Senators Smith and C. Krueger, ayes 59, nay 0.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 243 by Senator Grisanti, Center Print 3791, an act to amend the environmental conservation law.
Explanation, Senator Grisanti, has been requested.
Thank you, Mr. President. Basically, the purpose of this bill is to promote safety in and around stormwater retention ponds by amending the conservation law to require modification of the stormwater management design manual. This bill is specifically in place, and I asked for it because my good friend of mine's son drowned in one of these ponds. It's a safety issue for my area, safety issue across New York State. I'll be happy to ask any further questions anybody may have.
Senator Stewart Cousins.
Thank you. Would the sponsor yield for a question?
Santi, will you yield?
Absolutely.
Yes, Senator, I know that we discussed this in committee, and in committee I voted without rec because there were some questions that I had, and I'm hoping that I will get some answers, and certainly let this be on the record that I understood when you talked about it initially that this was the result of a very tragic incident, and so this has absolutely nothing to do with that. But I was wondering, in terms of the way the new regulations will be promulgated, how does it impact the existing, the retention ponds?
What's going to happen, Senator, is that, Mr. President, through, what's going to happen, Senator, is that some of the retention ponds have some of the criteria already, and I'll tell you what these are. It's going to require posting of warning signs. Some retention ponds have them, some don't. It's going to define a reasonable slope past the aquatic bench. Some of them have it, and some don't. It's going to basically any other provisions that DOC deems essential to further safety. It's going to ensure examination of the status of safety features. So when those are all taken in conjunction and have an aquatic vegetation, as I said, some of them have them and some don't. DEC is going to come out with a new manual. This particular legislation is going to speed up that process. Every 4 years they come out with a manual. The manual they have now is outdated. This is going to speed that up and to promote safety. And basically, if it doesn't have this particular retention pond, any of those items, they'll have to be installed or taken care of, whether it's owned by the state or a private individual, which is highly unlikely.
Okay, so then it sounds like it'll be an updated manual and the DEC will put these new requirements in. And so the existing stormwater retention ponds will have to, they won't be grandfathered. They will have to comply with the new regulations?
They have to comply with the new regulation. The DEC was going to update their manual anyways. This gives a little bit more criteria in a new section to say if you're going to update it, we would like these things in here. Now, DEC actually made some of the recommendations that are in this bill.
I understand that they do, but I guess I'm just trying to figure out how it exists. I mean, some of these retention... Oh, I'm sorry.
Would you like Senator Grisani
yes.
to continue to yield?
Would you continue to yield, Senator?
Yeah, through we're you? Old friends. We don't need to be okay. that formal. That's fine.
Okay.
I continue to yield.
Thank you. I appreciate that. So some retention ponds have been sort of abandoned for a very, very long time.
Correct.
I'm still trying to... So those kinds of ponds, whose responsibility would it become? Would it be the residents in the area? Would it be the municipality? Whose responsibility would these become?
Whoever owns the retention pond at that point, when the regs are updated every 4 years, will have the responsibility of making sure these particular items and items in the past are implemented.
Okay, so whoever was responsible, if they had not been, they will now have to become responsible, including maybe homeowners that surround a particular... So
that's correct.
So will there be now new liability then for... But sometimes, you know, commercial developers, they have the facility and the capacity to do this. But would this be something that the residents then would have to decide who's going to be responsible? Would they have a new bill? Would they have a new liability? Will they have to now get insurance? How does that impact, you know, the residents around a retention pond now? And how will they move forward?
My understanding, Senator, is that with this particular piece of legislation, it doesn't have any effect on liability because if it was a homeowners association that owned the retention pond anyways, that's taken into consideration when they actually purchase insurance. By actually having these added safety measures for the retention pond, what it's going to do is actually reduce their cost of insurance. With regards to the state side of it, the state has to have notice of any sort of dangerous condition. The state doesn't have notice, they have an argument then as far as a liability issue for arguing against being liable for something tragic that happens. But by installing these measures, God forbid a young boy or girl should happen to fall into these ponds, by having the slopes, having the aquatic vegetation, it gives them a better chance of survival rather than being a straight drop of 8-9 feet.
Well, one of the things in this he's going to continue. One of the phrases was the maintaining authority. That would be from your standpoint, who would that be? Would that be the local municipality, the building department? Who is coming out inspecting these ponds? Would it be the building authority now that will come and inspect everyone?
Under the regulation as it sets forth, they always have to go out and inspect. The DEC owns it, they're going to inspect their own. If there's a property owner that owns it, the DEC's having the regulation, they would inspect. Now, hopefully that's done, that inspection takes place.
DEC will begin to, will inspect. And if there's any, if there's some problem and they're not adhering to the regulations, what is the penalty?
We don't have a penalty phase at this point. The DEC, it says, any other provisions the department deems essential to further promote the safety in around the stormwater retention ponds will be up to them. I didn't put a penalty phase in there. They already go ahead as of now and regulate it. This is just adding a clause, modifying it, 170810, adding those other five criteria to provide safety for the retention ponds. It's not going to change any other requirements.
So there's not going to be a penalty if they don't do it, but this is a guide to tell people what should be done. Hopefully, if they are not currently meeting the standards, they will become on par with what the standards should be by signage and stuff.
I would say that's a fair assessment. Absolutely.
Thank you, Senator. On the bill.
Senator Cousins.
Yes, there were a number of questions that we were, hoping to get answered in light of certainly the tragedy that Senator Grisanti brought to our attention. And there are no penalties. It sounds like it's an additional thing for DEC to put into their manual so that people will be aware that there are standards, there is a process, there are certain procedures that would make these retention ponds certainly safer, and I'm sure that's what we want to do. I hope that the municipalities and I hope that those involved in creating these retention ponds, in addition to those who currently have retention ponds, will adhere to the fact that we can make them safer and save lives. So certainly I will be supporting the bill, and hopefully, again, this will be one way to pay honor to the child who drowned.
Thank you, Senator Stewart Cousins. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell. Again, we ask members to please come to the chamber for the vote.
Section 2 of this act shall take effect on the 180th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar 243 are Senators Gallivan, Griffo, Little, Ranzenhofer, and Ritchie. Absent from voting, Senator C. Krueger, Senator Smith,
Senator Larkin.
Also recorded in the negative are Senators Larkin. Ayes 53, nays 6.
Senator Libous. Bill, excuse me, Senator Libous. The bill is passed. Senator Libous.
Thank you, Mr. President. Before we can continue the non-controversial calendar, I'm somewhat disappointed that some of my colleagues will not stay in the chamber to listen to the interesting debate that is taking place, because when we get to the roll call, we are going to move along. And we will wait a reasonable period, and then we will move along. And if you're not here, you will be marked absent. So I would encourage my colleagues to listen to the debate. I'm finding it quite interesting, quite stimulating, and I wouldn't want you to lose out on what I'm gaining this afternoon. Thank you, Mr. President.
At your wise suggestion, Senator Libous, we will be moving along in the roll call, so we ask members to stay very close by, if not in their seats, for the debate and the vote. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 255 by Senator Griffo. Senate print 3641A, an act to amend the highway law.
Explanation has been requested. Senator Griffo.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill will allow towns to designate town roads as low volume and certain low volume roads to be minimum maintenance.
Yes, Mr. President. Thanks. Through you, will the sponsor yield for some questions?
Senator Griffo, will you continue to yield?
By all means, Senator Espaillat.
Thank you, Senator Griffo. I'm not a country boy. I'm a city boy, although I was born in a small town. And I wanted to know, perhaps you could enlighten us a little bit more about this particular issue, which is of great interest to all of us. And give me, if you can, an explanation. What is the difference between what is considered currently a town road as opposed to a low volume road?
Well, the bill, Senator Mr. President, through you, Senator Espaillat, the bill lays out the process for town boards to designate low volume and minimum maintenance roads. It's a process that would include a comprehensive study of the roadway. It would include a public hearing, and it would allow for these roads. We've all embraced the concept of mandate relief, and this is where this goes to, allowing flexibility within those townships for roads that are not highly traveled to deal with minimum maintenance on those roads. And I think the studies that are conducted show that about a 50-car use for a road is basically what this is.
If I may, Mr. President.
You continue to yield, Senator Griffo?
I don't think he's asked a question yet.
Yes. Are these dirt roads? How many lanes do they have? I mean, what is considered
a
low-volume road? Is it 6 lanes? Is it 8 lanes? Is it a throughway? Is it a dirt road? Is there a particular guideline that you look at to establish which is which? Or do you actually... have a vehicle count and establish that because of the volume of vehicles in the road, it establishes in a certain criteria.
Senator, Mr. President, through you, Senator Espeliot, as I indicated earlier, one of the counts used is 50 cars, vehicles, traveling a road. So that shows that if there's only studies are being done, if in 50 cars or less use the road in the course of a day, that indicates the level of usage. It also deals with a study that was done in 1992 by the Local Roads Research and Coordination Council, which defined and set standards for low volume and classification. And that was done to allow flexibility and to reduce costs to some of these towns where these roads, which are small roads, and I invite you to come upstate so we can show you many of these roads. We can always use, bring your money too, because it's very good to invigorate the economy.
Well, Mr. President, through you, if I may. I would love to visit those towns. I know that New York State is a beautiful state, and I'm sure that many of the neighborhoods in your region are beautiful, and many of us will enjoy being there. I know that similar bills were introduced through the Rural Resources Commission in the past, both in this chambers and in the lower house. Why not send this bill through the RRC?
Senator, Mr. President, through you, Senator Espeliot, this is a bill that was passed in this House. We now have an Assembly sponsor, Assemblywoman Gunther, and we think that this is the most appropriate course and the best course in order to provide the mandate relief that we all agree that is necessary and needed can be accomplished.
Okay. Mr. President, through you. Senator Griffo, has the Commission, the RRC, vetted this bill? Have they reviewed it appropriately and vetted this bill?
Mr. President, through you, Senator Espeliot, I believe that there's been no one that has expressed any opposition to this bill, to my knowledge. In fact, if anything, there are people that have supported the bill, such as we actually have people on both sides, not only the Association of Towns, but the Adirondack Council, too, which I know many of you on your side are very familiar with.
Do you, Mr. President? So do you feel that the Rural Resources Commission approves of this bill? Do they approve of it and they're supportive of it?
Could you repeat the question, Senator Espeliot?
Yes. Do you feel that the Rural Resources Commission approves of this particular bill?
Yes.
That would be my understanding because there has been no opposition expressed.
Yes, I'm the chair.
And the chair sits near me and has given me an unequivocal yes, Senator Espeliot.
Okay. We're happy to hear that. Mr. President, if I may. We are concerned, however, that there is a 5 days notice on public hearings regarding these changes, rather than perhaps a 10-day requirement, which has been included in previous similar bills. Is there a reason for the reduction in the public notice for this proposed road designation?
Mr. President, to the best of my knowledge, the town boards that would be making the designation would do it by local law, and there would be 30 days prior to a public hearing on that local law. If you look at town law, they specify how you do something like this, so there's proper notice given, and I believe it's consistent with local law, general municipal law, that would regulate something like this to allow for input and notification.
Mr. President, if I may?
Will you continue to yield, Senator Griffo?
Sure.
Do you feel that the 5 days is a sufficient amount of time for the public and affected property owners to prepare and argue their cause, their case to the governing body?
Well, again, Mr. President, through you, Senator Espeliot, as I said, if you look at this, there are a number of criteria for proper notice, and as far as I look at this, if you follow the public hearing requirements, there would be ample notice given. Not only how long it takes to mail to somebody, but there's plenty of opportunity in existing law, as well as in this, to allow for an open public awareness, public input into the process.
Mr. President, just one final question, if I may, to the sponsor.
Senator Griffo?
Sure.
Yes. Previous efforts to expand the universe of low volume and minimum maintenance roads has been based on their potential to reduce the cost for localities. Are there any considerations of potential savings for this particular legislation? And what are the fiscal implications or impact for the localities and regions?
Senator Aspeliat, through you, Mr. President, as I said, the town highway superintendents, the Association of Towns support this because they all indicate that there will be savings as a result of that opportunity to look at these low-volume roads and have minimal maintenance. In no way does it abandon maintenance. I want to make that perfectly clear. In fact, we can talk about the Beatles, the long and winding road, Senator Aspeliat, if I can quote from the long and winding road, that leads to your door will never disappear, to give you assurances.
Thank you, Mr. President. I prefer strawberry fields forever, but thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Is there any other senator wishing to be heard? The debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell. We ask members to please come to the chamber for the vote. Can I do it, Beth? Pull the trigger? Read the last section. No. Let's go, right? Yeah, let's just take a mess. Here we go. Read the last section.
Section 4 of this act should take effect on the 120th day.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Hey, tell him he's holding us up every time.
In relation to calendar 255, absent from voting are Senators Huntley, C. Krueger, and Smith. Ayes 58, nays 0.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 309 by Senator Grisanti, Senate Print 2877A, an act to amend the Environmental Conservation Law.
Explanation has been requested. Senator Grisanti.
Thank you, Mr. President. The purpose of this bill would revise the number of reverse vending machines that are required in certain businesses to redeem empty beverage containers based on the square footage of the store.
Is there...
Last section.
Senator Peralta.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor yield?
Senator Grisanti, will you yield?
I will, Mr. President. In the city?
Looking at this bill, I wanted to get a clear definition of what reverse vending machines is defined as under this bill.
Reverse vending machines, as it stands from a law that passed a couple years ago, required stores to have 8 of these machines in their facility based on square footage. What this is doing is saying that if you're between 40,000 and 60,000 square feet, you need 2 machines instead of 3. 60,000, 85,000 square feet, you need 3 instead of 4. Over 85,000 square feet, you have 4 machines instead of 8. Now, what does that do? Basically, some of these stores having 8 machines all across the state, you had hundreds of stores, hundreds of machines not being used, drawing serious power off the grid of New York State. On top of that, these stores are losing all this space, so it freed up valuable store space that is lost. Also included stores, probably in your area, Macy's, that had little refrigerators of $10 spirit water, they would call it. They'd have to have 3 machines in their stores. Not feasible. Stores like Home Depot and Lowe's They'd only sell bottled water to their contractors. Contractors would come in. I don't think the contractors are returning the water, bottled waters, back to Home Depot, who has to have 8 to 12 of these machines in their stores. So eliminates that burden. The recyclable rate is still not going to go down. But it also gives another exemption that allows that if you have another process by which to recycle, you don't need the machines altogether. Also known as the alternative technology, where you crush the containers, use it a different way. Certain stores in Maine actually use bags. They do it that way.
Mr. President, will the sponsor yield for another question?
Will you continue to yield,
yes,
Senator Grisanti?
I will. Yes, I will.
Now, with these reductions, these proposed reductions are the RVM machines, would you say that if you reduce it from, let's say, 8 to 4 in the 85,000 square foot store, that there may be a bigger nuisance created by the longer lines of individuals waiting on the small amount of RVM machines that exist?
That's always a possibility, but you got to remember, if a store is that large and it wants to have customer satisfaction, I'm not saying that they have to take their 8 machines and reduce it down. They want to have the additional machines, they can. This just gives them the option, if those 8 machines are not being used, you can go down to 4 machines instead of 8.
Would the sponsor you for another question?
Yes, Mr. President.
Indeed.
This seems to me like this piece of legislation will favor big box stores. I just find it unbelievable that a store that has 85,000 square feet will not have space for 8 RVM machines. I've noticed in my district the size of RVM machines, and they're about much smaller than the width of the clock in this Senate chamber, and definitely much smaller in terms of height. So 85,000 feet, and the argument is being used that it is too small to have 8 RVM machines, I find that unlikely. Why is there a need to reduce it from 8 to 4?
The machines have been upgraded so that they can handle more.
Machines in recent years have basically been upgraded to handle more of a capacity for recycled products. So even though the machines are smaller, the technology is better. Mm-hmm. So the 4 machines could possibly do the same work as 8. But having 8 of the older machines is causing a heavy drain, and they're larger. Maybe where your stores are, they're the newer machines. Some of the stores have the older machines that are much larger.
Mr. President, will the sponsor you for another question?
Senator Grisanti.
Yes, I will.
So currently, by law, how can you be sure that this legislation will not lead to a decrease in returns of recyclable bottles?
Because as I said before, the stores still have, to your spread, the stores still have the ability, they're going to have the machines, and these smaller machines produce double capacity of what the other machines had. They're still going to have the recyclable areas in their store. Now, basically, you got the Food Industry Alliance, Hannaford Retail Council of New York, Business Council, they're for this particular legislation because of what it does in terms of upgraded technology, maintains recyclable products, eliminates some of the space that is being taken up in the store. On top of that, the DEC does not oppose the bill either.
Mr. President, would the sponsor yield for another question?
Senator Grisanti, do you continue to yield?
Yes.
Now, currently, what ends up happening is by law, if you purchase the container, let's say at a big box store, you should be able to redeem the container at a big box store. But at least in the city, what ends up happening is you get a big box store, you can purchase a container at a big box store, and when you go back to redeem, what ends up happening is that they send you to the supermarket so that you can redeem the empty containers. So wouldn't this be disproportionate or a burden on the supermarkets, whom the big box stores keep on sending back to the supermarkets so that they can redeem these empty containers?
If the big box stores you're talking about that are not exempt from this legislation, they're supposed to have those machines. They're not supposed to be able to tell somebody you cannot return the recycled products here to go to a supermarket. So if that's the case, you probably need to make a complaint. But I saw the from Local 338, and I think it's a contradiction. They oppose the passage of this legislation by saying as more and more beverages are sold outside the traditional supermarkets, consumers must have the option to return beverage containers to the place which they purchased them. If this does not occur, then supermarkets bear a disproportionate share. This is exactly where you're getting this from. Today, supermarkets must use available retail space for RVMs. No consideration is given. So in your one argument, you're saying that, well, it doesn't take up a lot of space, but yet, you know, they don't have to come to the store. It's a contradiction. The store, if they're purchasing a product from a store that is required to have those machines, then all they simply need to do is make a complaint that I want to return it here rather than to a supermarket.
Would the President, Mr. President, would the sponsor you for another question?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, does this piece of legislation address any of the enforcement issues? Because as you stated earlier, that if there is a problem, you can file a claim. But time and time again, I know that at least in the city and some areas, some counties outside of the city, what tends on happening is that when you purchase a container or a product at a big box store, many of them do not redeem them. And what they end up doing is they send them right back to the supermarkets. So does your piece of legislation talk about an enforcement provision to help reduce this big problem?
This legislation only talks about the amount of reverse vending machines in a store. It doesn't talk about the regulations on penalties. I'm sure that somewhere else in the regulations where if you refuse to take recyclable products in your store. So they need to file a complaint, with whom I don't know. But that's not addressed in this bill. This bill only addresses the amount of machines.
Mr. President, would the sponsor you for another question?
EC.
Yes. So from time to time, I get many of these complaints in my district, and I'm pretty sure many of my other colleagues get similar complaints. So if we receive these complaints and it's only on an upward trend and it's growing, now this piece of legislation will ask for the reduction of RVM machines, not taking into account, especially during this heavy summer season, where people will wait long hours to redeem their empty containers. And sometimes, actually many times, you will have many of these machines broken. So if these machines are broken, now instead of having four lines, let's say, for example, in the 85,000 square feet store, you will have two or one line waiting to be redeemed. So if this is the case, and these redemptions are just increasing, these complaints are being increased, as especially during the summer, why are we reducing the amount of RVM machines when you should be increasing, if not keeping it level, so that way customers can be satisfied, they don't create a nuisance to the other customers that are actually shopping in the area? Why are we reducing?
On two occasions, the machines have upgraded technology where they can handle twice the amount of output as the older machines. The older machines are being replaced because they use up too much energy. So it's a cost factor. And as far as people that are waiting the entire summer to return some of their products, I can't address that issue on why somebody else is hanging on to their recyclable products. You could also return these products over the counter if the machine is broken.
On the bill, Mr. President.
On the bill, Senator Peralta.
I understand that Senator Grisanti has good intentions with this bill, but this bill actually shortchanges supermarkets by placing an unfair burden on them. And it disproportionately, the shares of the costs will end up at supermarkets. This is not an equitable bill, since it favors big box stores. Many of the enforcement policies that are in place do not really work, and we need to work on that. This bill doesn't address the obligation of accepting empty containers, even when RVMs aren't working, which in turn increases the lines and creates a nuisance for other customers. This bill doesn't address the real issue of enforcement, as I said previously, where the real problem with these RVM machines is that big box stores end up sending many of the customers or people that want to redeem their empty containers back to the supermarkets. I hoped that today we would be talking about more substantive issues like the extension or the strengthening of rent regulations, but I see that today is not that day. So I am going to be voting in the negative on this one, and I urge all my colleagues to do the same. Thank you.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing none, the debate is closed. Oh, Senator Krueger.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. On the bill.
On the bill.
Thank you. I appreciated very much the given back and forth, and I respectfully agreed with all the questions that Senator Peralta asked Senator Grisanti, but I find myself coming to the opposite conclusion. I don't think this bill covers all the issues we need to. I think that the points that Senator Peralta was making about the importance of enforcement require additional exploration in this House. I am not opposed to this bill, but I would like to reemphasize for the record, as Senator Peralta was highlighting, that in the city of New York, we are finding that certain kinds of stores, disproportionately pharmacies, which I won't name the names, but a number of chain pharmacies, they sell a significant quantity of cold drinks and bottled beverages that fall under the bottle bill in New York State. Probably they don't meet the 5% standard of their floor space, but the irony is they do incredibly rapid turnover. So it's probably more than 5% of the product they sell, if not 5% of the floor space at any given time, and they are not, I believe, following the correct laws of New York State as far as agreeing to take the bottles back. So we do find ourselves in the city of New York with a situation where relatively small supermarkets, because in my borough, Manhattan, we don't have space for anything, so our supermarkets aren't really super the way you would define them as such in the rest of the state. Relatively small food stores with limited space to sell their product end up having to take responsibility for taking back far more containers than they've actually sold, which is a problem for them in trying to master being able to operate their stores correctly. So the bill itself, I believe, is a good bill. I think this legislature needs to go further in exploring both enforcement and expanded options such as the right sizing of reverse vending machines and other options that might be available. So I look forward to working with Senator Grisanti in the future to exploring further where we can go to expand and improve the bottle bill system in New York State, making sure that we encourage recycling, we encourage the users to return the bottles, but we also come up with a system that is fair and equitable for all retailers so that some don't end up taking on a greater share of responsibility for returns than others. So I'll be voting yes, Mr. President. Thank you.
Senator Espiat.
President, on this bill, remember that when we had the debate for the bigger bottle bill, one of the issues that continuously came up was the fact that many stores, particularly those in the city of New York, smaller supermarkets, if you may, bodegas, felt that by increasing the bottle bill, by approving the bigger bottle or the bigger bottle bill, that they would see an increase in the hand, a 25% increase in the handling of bottles. And that as a result, they will have to cut into their storage space. So if you had now water bottles coming in, Snapple bottles coming in, you will have to maybe go into your basement and take up 25% of your storage space in a bodega. And this will have an adverse condition, an adverse impact on the business. As a result, when we discussed the bigger bottle bill, we made some adjustments to address this particular issue. the fact that smaller supermarkets will now have to take an increase of 25% in the handling of bottles. Now, by allowing big box stores not to have the required number of vending machines, what we're saying is that these big box stores will now send their beverage bottles to the smaller operations, to the local supermarkets and the local bodegas. And they will now have to handle an increased amount of bottles in their daily activities, which would again have an impact on their operation, often bringing rodents to their basement, having a series of problems accommodating their stores, their small stores that are strapped for space to handle this workload. So I will be voting in the negative, Mr. President. I think that this is a bill that disproportionately hurts smaller businesses, precisely the ones that provide jobs for the state of New York. We must remember that small businesses are the ones that are the engine to the economy of New York State, and this will further hurt them. I will be voting in the negative.
Senator Squadron.
I hear the sponsor yield for a question. Mr. President.
Yes, Senator Santi, will you yield?
Yes, and to get to the other senator's question beforehand, those stores do not have to have the RVM machines or accept containers. Go ahead, Senator Squadron.
Thank you. Thank you to the sponsor. This reduces the number of RVMs for stores of a number of different sizes. The largest reduction on a number basis, on a fractional basis, is in stores over 85,000 square feet. The sponsor just described, and I know you got close to this issue, but with the sponsor mind just describing what, that's a lot of square feet if you're from New York City. That's, you know, 90 homes in New York City or 110 homes. What supermarkets or food stores would fall into that greater than 85,000 square foot category?
The original language that is talks about the 40 to 60, 60 to 85 is the original language from the prior bill from a couple of years ago. We're not changing that, and it passed 61-0, something that was voted on. So we're not changing any of that.
Right. If the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Right. I understand that. But again, the largest reduction here that we're talking about is in this category of really very, very, very large. Very, 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 very large stores. And I'm just wondering, 85,000 square feet is hard for me to envision. It seems to me that you might have a couple of sort of supermarkets, maybe the largest Wegmans in the state, maybe one of the super, I can't imagine even a Price Chopper, but you know, that you're also talking largely about Walmarts and Targets. Would that be sort of a fair guess?
I haven't been measuring Tops or Wegman stores, but I would assume that Wegmans would probably be, Super Wegmans in my area would probably be about that size, 85,000.
Good. And a Walmart or a Target, sorry, sponsor deal, the Walmart or a Target.
Correct.
So thank you very much to the sponsor. You know, the concern that I would have with this bill would be not so much that Wegmans, which, you know, does a lot of business, is clearly in the category here. I'm actually mostly worried about a Walmart or a Target of great deal of size that has less than 5%. Devoted to groceries, that today has an RVM, it's a large business, it does a great deal of volume, that no longer would. And to me, that's the greatest concern in this bill. It's the reason I'm not going to be able to support it, though I think there are some admirable parts of it. I thank the sponsor for helping me clarify.
Debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell. We ask to... as expeditiously as possible, please come to the chamber for a vote.
Lavelle. Okay. Read the last section.
Section 2 of this act to take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Got no's. Hey, Chris, let's go.
Announce the results.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 309, those recorded in the negative are Senators Diaz, DeLon, Espaillat, Gianaris, Parker, Peralta, Rivera, Squadron, and Stavisky. Absent from voting are Senators Dwayne, Hassel Thompson, C. Krueger, Montgomery, and Smith. Ayes 47, nays 9.
Bill is passed. Senator Libous. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, the Senate will stand at ease for 5 minutes, and I would ask members not to go far because we will then come back and address what's left on the calendar. But just we're at ease for 5 minutes. Please, I would ask members to stay in the chamber or right outside.
The Senate will stand at ease. We ask members to stand close by. Senator Breslin.
Thank you, Mr. President. During that five-minute period, there will be a quick Democratic conference in room 314.
There will be a Democratic conference. Room 314.
That will come to order. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, can we now take up on the controversial calendar bill number, calendar number 427 by Senator Young?
Secretary will read.
Calendar number 427 by Senator Young, Senate Print 2835, an act to amend the criminal procedure law.
An explanation has been requested by Senator Krueger. Senator Young, an explanation has been...
Happy to give an explanation momentarily.
President.
Senator Young.
The Common Council in the City of Salamanca in Cattaraugus County requested this legislation. Peace officers may only be designated by an express act of the New York State Legislature, and this legislation would permit the city's dog control officer to issue court appearance tickets for the purpose of enforcing Article 26 of the New York State Ag and Markets Law.
Senator Krueger.
Thank you, Mr. President. If the sponsor would please yield.
Well, may I have some order in the chamber, please? Senator Young, do you yield?
Certainly.
Thank you. So this is a peace officer bill for animal control officers in the city of Salamanca. I'm sorry?
Salamanca.
Salamanca, excuse me. How big is the city of Salamanca?
City of Salamanca is roughly around 7,000 to 8,000 people.
Thank you. How many? Oh, through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator yields.
Thank you. How many animal control officers are there in the city?
Through you, Mr. President. Actually, I believe that these duties have been supported by the police department. It's important to note that the city of Salamanca is going through a severe crisis right now. The Seneca Nation has not paid the casino revenues for 3 years, and part of their budget is based on that. So this would help alleviate some of the pressure because about half the city workforce has had to have been laid off. So this would provide the animal control duties, and it would be by somebody who is specially trained, but it also would be at a lower cost so that those duties could be handled.
Mr. President, if through you, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator Young, do you yield?
Certainly.
Senator yields.
Thank you. And I apologize. I don't think I quite understood the answer. I understood that the city is in a financial crisis, as so many of our towns and cities are. But I believe I heard the sponsor say that currently the animal control officers are police in the city. So could I just clarify again, are there animal control officers? How many of them are there, or in fact, do other staff of the city serve that function today?
I believe that, through you, Mr. President, I believe that there may be one animal control officer right now, but they want to designate it as a police or as a peace officer. And as I stated previously, this would provide support to the Salamanca Police Department that is experiencing a significant shortage of officers right now due to a fiscal crisis that they're experiencing.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Certainly.
Thank you. Okay, so I appreciate the answer because I didn't understand the direction you were explaining. So because the city of Salamanca has a shortage of funds, it doesn't actually have potentially enough police officers so that the animal control officer or officers would be functioning as peace officers to supplement the police force, not the police force supplementing the animal control
correct.
Force. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. If through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator Young yields.
Yes.
Thank you. Are animal control officers elected or appointed?
Through you, Mr. President, I believe that they are appointed, and that's why the Common Council in the City of Salamanca requested this legislation.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Senator yields.
Thank you.
What are the current qualifications for somebody to be an animal control officer in the city of Salamanca?
Through you, Mr. President, I'm not really sure to be an animal control officer, but I will point out that this legislation deals with having somebody designated as a peace officer. I will remind the senator that last year there was legislation that was voted on by this House and passed through the legislative process that gave further training and different standards than previously held for peace officers. So if the senator's concern is that there would not be enough training or the high enough standards that would be necessary, that was addressed last year.
Thank you, Mr. President. Through you, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator yields.
Thank you. I didn't forget that there was a change in the status for what a peace officer training needs to be. Appreciate the senator's pointing that out. So this would give, as I understand it under her bill, the power to make warrantless arrests that would be given to the animal control officers. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And would this bill actually allow animal control officers who then became peace officers to apply for gun permits to carry guns for their work?
No, it would not.
Mr. President, on the bill.
Senator Krueger on the bill.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate the sponsor's responses. This bill was vetoed previously, and I suspect it may face a veto again. For me, it's not this one bill. I am consistent in voting against most peace officer bills. For the same reasons, I will be voting against this. I am greatly disturbed to hear that there is a town that doesn't believe they have an adequate police force and wants to give their animal control officer or officers police powers or peace officer powers, including the power to do warrantless arrests, to follow through on criminal activities and investigations. I am disturbed that there are not enough police to provide those services, but I don't believe the solution is to give those powers to people who are not police officers or law enforcement officers. I don't think that it is in the best interest of the state of New York to continue the expansion of what I have seen now for the 8.5 years that I have been here in the Senate, a continuing push to categorize various people with various job descriptions and job functions having really nothing to do with law enforcement, to give them the powers of law enforcement, to give them the power to arrest, to investigate, to follow through on criminal charges without there actually being police officers or trained as law enforcement officers. I think it's a serious mistake for the state of New York. And I don't know, to be fair, whether this bill in giving an animal control officer the authority or much of the authority of a police officer is more disturbing to me than times where we have categorized other workers in private or local governments, those powers. But again, I think that for New York State to continue to have a sub-universe of people who seem to have many of the authorities and powers of police within our towns, our courts, our hospitals, our schools, and now our animal control units, I think it's a serious error in public policy and that we should be seriously reevaluating this broader and broader spectrum of who we give police authority to. I'll be voting no, Mr. President. Thank you.
Is there any other senator wishing to be heard?
Senator Young.
Yes, Mr. President, on the bill.
Senator Young on the bill.
Just want to clarify something that my colleague said. Basically, this bill would follow the ag and markets law in New York State, and it would allow someone to serve as an animal control officer, not as a police officer. That definitely is not the purpose of this bill, and it's not what this bill does. But what it would allow is the police officers to be police officers and to stop crime and provide safe streets and help people and save their lives, quite frankly. So that's the intent of this bill. That's what this bill does. And I would urge all of my colleagues to vote yes.
Is there any senator wishing to be heard? Seeing none, hearing none, debate is closed. Secretary will ring the bell.
There he is.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act to take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, E. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 427, those recorded in the negative are Senators Espaillat, Hassel-Thompson, L. Krueger, Montgomery, Parker, Perkins, Rivera, Serrano, Squadron, and Stavisky. Absent from voting are Senators Duane, Huntley, C. Krueger, and Smith. Ayes 47, nays 10.
The bill is passed. Senator Libous.
Mr. President, after consultation with my colleague, the Deputy Minority Leader, Senator Breslin, could we at this time have the remaining bills that are on the controversial calendar restored to the non-controversial calendar and then read in order of what's left on that non-controversial calendar?
Without objection, the chair so orders, and the secretary will read.
Calendar number 320 by Senator Fuchsia, Senate Print 4070, an act to amend the vehicle and traffic law.
Last second.
Section 3, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 60, nays 1. Senator L. Kruger recorded in the negative.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 347 by Senator Lavelle, Senate Print 3237, an act to amend the Agricultural Markets Law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Senator Stavisky to explain her vote.
To explain my vote, I simply want to thank Senator Lavelle. This was such a good bill that I passed it last year in my name.
Senator Stavisky to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Ayes 60, nays 1. Senator Squadron recorded in the negative.
Bill is passed. Secretary will read.
Calendar number 348 by Senator DeFrancisco, Senate Print 3317, an act amending Agricultural Markets Law.
Last section.
Section 2 of this act to take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 349 by Member of the Assembly Cahills, Assembly Print 6373A, an act to amend the Agricultural Markets Law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 383 by Senator Bonasek, Senate Print 3579, an act to amend the Rural Electric Cooperative Law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act should take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 415 by Senator Klein, Senate Print 1677, an act to amend the executive law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 438 by Senator Savino, Senate Print 2138. An act to amend the workers' compensation law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
Bill is passed.
Calendar number 523 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 4803. An act to amend the public health law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
We're on bill number 4803, calendar 523.
In relation to calendar 523, those recorded in the negative are Senators L. Kruger and Squadron. Ayes 59, nays 2.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 547 by Senator Griffo, Senate Print 4521, an act to amend the public authorities law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act will take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Those recorded in the negative on calendar 547 are Senators L. Kruger and Perkins. Ayes 59, nays 2.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 555 by Senator Nozzolio, Senate Print 464, an act to amend the penal law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act to take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Livis, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin.
Senator Gianaris to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. This bill takes a proposal that we've passed as it applies to correction officers who deal very often with the problem in prisons of prisoners throwing excrement or saliva on the officers, and we properly passed a bill providing protection for those types of people. This bill expands that very drastically. It even includes peace officers. We just voted for a bill that would give peace officer status to dog control officers in Salamanca. And now we're suggesting that if someone should spit either on such a peace officer or in the context of a protest, perhaps spitting and hitting the shoe of a police officer, this would make that a felony and subject that person to prison time. I think it is very overbroad. In fact, it also includes EMTs and paramedics, where you may have situations where someone who's having an epileptic fit in an ambulance may inadvertently be charged with a felony if some kind of bodily fluid were to be excreted onto those officials. So I will be voting in the negative. I believe this bill goes way too far and is overbroad.
Senator Gianaris to be recorded in the negative. Announce Senator Nozzolio to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. My colleagues, this measure should be supported. Unfortunately, in today's society, in today's world, spitting, using excrement as a weapon can be a very dangerous situation, particularly if that individual has a serious disease, whether it be hepatitis, HIV, that becomes a deadly weapon. My colleagues who try to trivialize it are, in fact, I believe, insensitive to the needs of those emergency medical personnel and those other law enforcement officers that are literally laying their lives on the line. Those who do not support this measure do not support their efforts, and that's why this measure is important to get passed and to see stronger penalties for those who are, in effect, using their bodily fluids as weapons. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Rivera to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will join my colleague, Senator Gianaris, and vote in the negative in this bill. Senator Nozzolio and I had a debate on this bill in the Crime Victims, Crimes and Correction Committee. I also believe that it is a bill that is too broad and goes too far. It creates a situation where, I mean, we already have laws that protect peace officers and police officers if they are attacked, if somebody wants to, it pushes them or attacks them, we already have laws that protect them. And they certainly can arrest the person that is trying to do this, charge them with either resisting arrest or attempted assault. There are many other charges that can be brought upon these people. This seems to me to be way broad, and really, since it's open to interpretation, many of these situations that Senator Gianaris described, in which someone might inadvertently have bodily fluid land on a police officer or a peace officer, all of a sudden finds himself potentially liable for a felony. I think it is too serious an expansion, and I will be voting in the negative in this bill. Thank
you, Senator Rivera, to be recorded in the negative. Senator Ruth Hassel Thompson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. President. Just for the record, I'd like to make a correction in a statement that was made. Senator Nozzolio, it is not possible to transmit HIV and AIDS through saliva. And I think that the act of spitting and whatever is considered to be disgusting and all the other things that you said, but I think it's very appropriate that we be very careful that we, when we talk about transmitting something as serious as HIV, that we get our information correct. Thank you, Mr. President.
How do you vote, Senator Hassel-Thompson?
I'm voting in the negative.
Senator Hassel-Thompson to be recorded in the negative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 556, those recorded in the negative are Senators Breslin, DeLon, Espaillat, Gianaris, Hassel-Thompson, L. Kruger, Montgomery, Parker, Perkins, Rivera, Sampson, Serrano, Squadron, and Stavisky. Ayes 47, nays 14.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 557 by Senator Marcelino, Senate Print 946. An act to amend the penal law.
Last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes.
Senator Squadron, explain his vote.
Just briefly, I commend Senator Marcelino on this bill. There is a definition in current law of comfort animals that is more expansive even than dogs and cats. I would love to see this bill expanded to all of those, whether the snake, the fish, or the pot-bellied pig. I vote in the affirmative.
Mr. Senator President. Squadron to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results. Senator, announce the results.
In relation to calendar 557, those recorded in the negative are Senators Montgomery, Parker, and Perkins. Ayes 58, nays 3.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 558 by Senator Golden, Senate Print 1991, an act to amend the penal law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Adam C. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 568 by Senator Farley, Senate Print 4564, an act to legalize, validate, and ratify.
Last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 596 by member of the Assembly, Godfrey. Assembly print 3338. Enact amend the public health law.
Last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 90th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill's passed.
Calendar number 616 by Senator Ball. Center print 5270. Enact amend the penal law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 1st of November.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill's passed.
Calendar number 630 by Senator Maziar. Center print 3793. Enact authorizing the town of Carlton.
There's a home rule message at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 60, nays 1. Senator L. Kruger recorded in the negative.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 636 by Senator Marcelino. Center print 4229. Enact amend the Suffolk County Tax Act.
There's a home rule message at the desks. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 668 by member of the Assembly, Paulin. Assembly print 6823. Enact to amend the social services law.
Last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on June 1, 2011.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. Ayes 61.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 684 by Senator Grisanti. Center print 2650. Enact amend the environmental conservation law.
Last section.
Section 6, this act shall take effect on the 1st of January.
Call the roll.
Adams, D. Francisco, Libous, Sampson, Skelos, Zeldin. In relation to calendar 684, those recorded in the negative are Senators Perkins and Serrano. Ayes 59, nays 2.
Bill's passed.
Calendar number 732 by Senator Saland, Center Print 4921, enact amend the education law.
Last section.
Section 9, this act shall take effect on the same date in the same manner as Chapter 42 of the laws of 2010.
Senator Saland to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, I know everybody in this chamber is well aware of the fact that bullying, in many respects, has reached almost epidemic proportions and is no longer the kind of thing we once referred to as childhood antics. In an effort to try and deal with some of these things, this House, both houses, have passed the SAVE legislation some 10 years ago, passed as recently as last year, the Dignity for All Students Act, a critically important piece of legislation to which Senator Duane and others were certainly dedicated and did a marvelous job of attaining its enactment. There were, however, gaps that have been left in the protection afforded those who we would seek to protect from bullying. And what this bill does is tries to deal with the entire universe. It's far more expansive. It tries to deal with bullying and cyberbullying, which currently are not covered under New York's law, in a fashion in which the creation of a hostile environment or substantially impairing a student's ability to perform in school or substantially impairing his or her ability to obtain an education becomes relevant to the actual occurrence of the bullying, so that somebody who is being tormented, for example, because of the clothes they wear, because of some alleged misdeed, because of the fact that their hair is different, the fact that they may walk funny, the fact that they may talk funny, the fact that they may have a poor complexion, and I can go on and on and on, would now have protection afforded under the school's codes of conduct that would be afforded anybody currently under the existing law. This legislation, hopefully, will pass in both houses before the session is over. It is long overdue, and I would hope that we will have a bipartisan effort, bipartisan bill, that will do the one thing we all claim we want to do, which is to protect children. No more egregious acts, no more fatalities, no more suicides, no more demonizing, no more torturing. let's provide better tools. Thank you, Mr. President. Obviously, I vote in the affirmative.
Senator Solana, be recorded in the affirmative. Call the roll.
Adams, DeFrancisco, Libous, Sampson, Scales, Zeldin. Ayes, 61.
The bill is passed. Senator Libous, that completes the reading of the calendar.
We did that. Didn't we do that? We did that. Mr. President, can we go back to motions and resolutions?
Return to motions and resolutions. Senator Libous.
On behalf of Senator Fuscillo, page 19, I offer the following amendments. Calendar number 219, Senate print number 628. As the said bill retain its place on the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received and the bill will retain its place on third reading.
On behalf of Senator Skelos, on page 45, I offer the following amendments. The calendar number 637, print 4264, and as said bill retains place in the third reading calendar.
The amendments are received and the bill will retain its place on third reading.
Mr. President, is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business, Senator Libous.
Mr. President, I hear a lot of noise and I'd like to make an announcement because members will want to hear this. There'll be a Republican conference tomorrow morning at 10 a.m.
There will be a Republican conference at 10 a.m. tomorrow morning, June 2nd.
The Senate will adjourn at this time until Tuesday, June 2nd at 11 a.m. Thursday. The other tea day, Thursday.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Thursday, June 2nd at 1:30 p.m. Senate adjourn 11 a.m. at 11 a.m. On motion. On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Thursday, 11 a.m., June 2nd. Senate adjourned.